Welcome to the virtual lunch. Today is a Thursday, June 4th. It's virtual lunch number 59. And very, very honored to have Jeena Cho on today. Jeena, welcome.
So I used to practice consumer bankruptcy law. And then I, like a lot of people, was completely stressed out and super duper anxious. And I guess the long, maybe the short story is that I was eventually diagnosed with social anxiety disorder, and I went through a whole battery of treatment programs. And what I learned is that there was nothing wrong with me. It's actually sort of our legal system and how we train lawyers to deal with stress and anxiety that is really the problem. Like, we know this profession is inherently stressful, that the work that we do can leave trauma and obviously cause stress and anxiety. And so I really learned a lot about mindfulness and meditation, and what it taught me as not only tools for managing stress and anxiety, but also to live a more fulfilling life, which I don't know, it's weird because I feel like as a profession, we kind of like frown upon that. Like, you tell someone like, I'm a happy lawyer, and they just look at you like, what's wrong with you? I don't trust you. Part of the journey from healing from social anxiety was that I actually had to go out there and do the thing that scared the hell out of me, which was like my top of the list things was public speaking. So I used to get like anxiety around even talking to clients on the phone. And what I realized later was that so much of that was because when I'm talking to my clients, you know, no one ever comes to see me with happy news. And just hearing the heartbreaking stories of my client was really having an impact on me. So I started doing more and more public speaking engagements around stress and anxiety management for lawyers. And then I got a book deal with the ABA, and I co-authored a book titled The Anxious Lawyer. So now I spend almost all of my time, I still practice just a tiny little bit, but for the most part, I teach lawyers how to use the tools of mindfulness and meditation to reduce stress and anxiety. And so I teach in law firms and bar associations. I do some like one-on-one coaching as well. Talking about your internal struggle is a very, obviously very personal. And especially in the legal profession, like, we don't encourage vulnerability. Like, you're never supposed to tell anyone. So much of that, it actually contributes to that sense of, you know, isolation and aloneness. And we know that when someone feels isolated, that actually increases the likelihood of struggling with mental health issues like depression. I find that when I'm talking about, you know, things like self-care and mindfulness and just being a good friend to yourself, one of like the primary objection that I get from lawyers is, well, I'm way too busy. Like, I don't have 10 minutes to meditate, and I don't have 10 minutes to, you know, like, even just sit down and eat my meal and without being in front of a screen. And I feel like that's sort of like one of the big obstacles for even talking about these issues with lawyers, because if you're not busy, then you must not be a good lawyer. And there's like a level of stigma in saying like, oh, I'm going to go for an hour long yoga class today and not bill for that 1 hour. I think law firms are now more concerned about the well-being of their employees because everyone's working remotely. So you don't even have the benefit of being able to see that person, you know, every day. The ABA doing studies on lawyer well-being and just showing the very scary, you know, rate of depression and substance abuse and, you know, things like that has brought awareness. And the elephant in the room that we need to address as a profession is how we earn a living, as we, you know, sell 6 minutes of our time for in exchange for money. And I feel like that inherently causes a conflict when it comes to doing anything else. The billable hour is something that they started talking about when I was in law school, and that was over a decade ago, and it doesn't seem like it's about to shift anytime soon. Really prioritizing and saying, what are the top three things that are the most important to me in my life? And, you know, I'm going to guess for most people, like, your mental and physical well-being, your family, your friends are probably going to rank higher than being able to bill that extra 0.1 hour. And then saying, well, if those are your priorities, then how are you actually spending your time, right? Because there's often a misalignment between how you spend your time and what your priorities are. If we could move to some alternative fee arrangement, right, that dynamic of having to spend every single minute of my day, having every single minute of my day be accounted for, would certainly shift, right? And I think there would be a lot more push for like efficiency. And I think that's the kind of crazy thing about this model of exchanging time for money is that it actually encourages inefficiency. So one nonprofit that I've worked with, it's a legal nonprofit. First, you know, they sort of instituted this thing about, you know, well-being, and that well-being is one of the core foundations of what we believe in, right? It's like, we believe in serving our clients excellently. And part of that is that, you know, like our entire team has to be well in all the different sense of the word. So really defining well-being and wellness very broadly. And they asked everyone to write out their own self-care strategy and actually share it. So, and so that everyone in the office felt empowered to say, you know what, I have way too much on my plate. I'm sorry, I can't do that. Or they would say, you know, I have this other, I'm going to go to yoga today. I'm leaving at 4:30 and I'm going to go to yoga today. And no one would be like, you know, there wasn't that element of, I don't know, shaming or, you know, so there was this expectation that everyone takes really good care of themselves. And I think that's the shift that needs to happen. I partnered with University of Western Ontario, and we actually did an 8-week mindfulness program at Safer Shaw. And we had the group go through this mindfulness program, and we were actually able to show that, you know, stress and anxiety, went down, right? Like, lawyers are not that special. It's just like every other population, stress and anxiety goes down when you practice mindfulness and meditation, productivity increases. I think there's this expectation that the practice of law has to be miserable and that you just have to like work to death in order to be a good lawyer. And I feel like no amount of data can sort of overcome that bias.
Jeena Cho!
Thank you.